Good morning. Great pleasure to be here, my first time in Australia. And I'm trying to put in this 20 minutes something which would be worth 50 hours of traveling. We'll see how, we'll see how it works. I work in Central European University, and it's a private small university funded by George Soros, which focuses on challenges of the 21st century. So in the next 20 minutes, I'm going to talk about four things. I'm first going to talk about how to define and assess energy security. Because if you look into global prospects for 21st century, you need to have some conceptual clarity of what it is you're talking about. Secondly, I will illustrate some of my concepts looking at today's global energy vulnerabilities, just so that we have some, you know, tangible feelings of them. And then discuss those very prospects of the 21st century. And finally, talk a bit about the research agenda, which I see here in multidisciplinary studies of energy security. Well, let me start with this one, with defining and assessing energy security. And I would like to express my admiration for the whole atmosphere of this conference. I would never dare to organize a conference where people speak about taxes and energy and food in the same go. But even though I'm used to multidisciplinary environments, and I think sometimes this multidisciplinarity plays very interesting, stories with us. And I'll tell you one story as an introduction to how I look at energy security. The story begins in 1981. There was a journal called Medical Care. And this journal developed a concept of how people access medical care. And in this concept, they came up with a very catchy so-called five A's of medical care, which are called availability, accessibility, accommodation, affordability, and acceptability. Very easy to remember, right? Well, in 2007, there was a meeting in Asia and a workshop produced by the energy security research. And I bet they thought these are very good A's. But one of them didn't really fit. So they crossed it out. And they said, well, there are these four A's of energy security. Right? Well, I was OK. Maybe that was in the purpose of this workshop. But in 2009, 2 years later, there was an article published in Energy Policy which focused on European energy security in the long term. It was an article in terms of a team of Dutch scientists, very heavy on modeling. And what they do, they make this availability, accessibility, affordability, and acceptability once again. And then guess what? It becomes among the most cited energy security kind of, assessment frameworks, right? Well, and that's very nice because four A's are very easy to remember. But the questions a scientist would ask, what is the theoretical foundation, right? What is empirical evidence that these four A's are actually have something to do with energy security? Where is the, my computer didn't like what I'm saying. right. Well, it probably is a bit controversial. But the last thing I wanted to say is that these four A's can be interpreted in a very different way. Just think of affordability, right? That's the concept you can stretch about this high. I'm not even talking about acceptability. And then how useful it is. Like, what can you do with these four A's? Can you evaluate something in the 21st century in Africa in 2018? Well, I don't think so. Now, the field of energy security is actually very, very bitter and divided field. People argue a lot what is energy security. Like, there are a group of people who say, well, it's about oil and fossil fuels, and people who say that's about everything in energy. It's about energy literacy and access, energy poverty, and energy sustainability and everything else. Now, there are people who say, well, it's about conventional security, security of the state, and people who say, no, it's about human security, right? Well, there is also people who say it's the same for each country. You can actually compare countries. And I say, no, 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 it's very contextual. Each country has their own view. There is no point of international comparisons. And then, of course, as every social science issue, there are people who say we can write formulas and estimate it objectively, and people who would say it's all politically constructed, right? You, there is no point. Now, right, that's what I call it. Now, I see my mission as a scientist and as to move away from this confusion and to try to create a science of energy security, which is a bit more rigorous, a bit more empirically based, and kind of a bit more useful, hopefully. And the starting point for creating this is how you define energy security. And I find this particular definition of energy security very useful. It's a low vulnerability of vital energy systems. Right? And let me explain what I mean by vital energy systems. And I put some kind of, you know, pictures here. You can think of pictures and make your own associations. But here are two important parts of this vital energy system concept. One, that the vital energy system is a system. That means there are elements of energy which are connected to each other. And if there is disruption, they can replace each other. But it's very difficult to replace it with other things. Like if you have oil, right, it doesn't make sense to mix it with gas because you cannot drive your cars on gas. It's not the same system. In some situations it is the same, but in many situations it is not. Well, and the second thing, that should be a system to have relevant to energy security. It should be a system which supports critical social functions. The functions, if you don't support them, the society will be destabilized. It won't survive. Here are some illustrations. If you look here, this is the Red Army airplane in the World War II, filled in with American kerosene. All kerosene in the Red Army was American. Soviet Union wouldn't be able to fight Germany without that particular energy system. And that's actually the origin of many energy security concepts. It's basically fuel for the military. It's critical and it's a system, right? Well, here is another interesting thing. That's North Korea. No oil. How do they drive the trucks? You know? We don't know. We saw this picture, but nobody knows. But the experts believe that it's a wood gas, so that they gasify wood, right? That's how important is transportation. Well, another thing on vital energy system, I don't know if you see this map, it's the gas networks in Europe, right? For some countries, vital energy systems are actually the energy exports. Countries like Russia or Saudi Arabia, if there is no energy export, they won't be able to survive. The vital social functions are supported by energy exports. There is nothing to replace it, right? So that this concept is very useful. And when you look at vital energy systems, you can divide them geographically or sectorally. And then you can connect them, you know, how they are connected. And then you can evaluate, you can do energy security assessment. That's what we did in global energy assessment. We looked at every country, we looked at the energy systems, we saw what is critical, and then we tried to make kind of global conclusions. Well, before I explain what was the result, let me also talk a bit about the second concept, the concept of vulnerability. Right, and once again, you know, there is a lot of talk about vulnerability. People talk about volatile prices and high prices and critical infrastructure and geopolitics, and it's all talk like in one breath, right? Well, I hope and I believe that some structure of this would be very helpful. And I developed a concept which I called three perspectives on energy security, where I divide this use of vulnerability depending on how we perceive risks, how we look at the risks in the future. And there are three fundamentally different ways to perceive risks. Like one way to perceive risks is that the risk is coming from the bad guys, you know, from the Arabs or, you know, whatever, Russians, etc., right? And that it is them who impose risks in our future. And our way to ensure security is to make sure we have control over energy, not them. And that, of course, there is a lot of political science and international relations here. Well, another way to look at risks is to say you can calculate risks. You look how much oil is left, that's your risk. How old is your power plant? That's your risk. It doesn't come from bad guys, it comes from your systems. Right, and I call this perspective robustness, and it's very much reliant on engineering and natural science. Now, finally, there are also people who believe you can't, you know, assess future risks. They are uncertain. You don't know what will happen. So the only way to ensure security is to make sure that energy systems are resilient, that they can respond to whatever disruptions come. Right? And I call this school resilience, and it has a lot of roots in economics and complexity science. Now, as you can imagine, these people, they have very great difficulty talking to each other. And this is one of the problems of how to evaluate energy security. It's completely different epistemological communities, as you say, right? Now, let me go with these concepts in mind to global energy assessment. It's your little pocketbook reading made by Cambridge Energy Press in 2012. It's only about 1,900 pages, but... Well, that's what happens when people try to do everything. But I work with a team of scientists on just one chapter, on energy and security. And there is a lot of, you know, it's a long chapter. And I just want to illustrate how these concepts which I just described, how they are used in this chapter. Well, that is a very simple graph. It shows population and countries which import dependency, which is either very high or kind of moderate, and by three fuels, right? And if you look here, you can make a very simple conclusion that most people live in countries importing most of their oil. So like if you take an average citizen on Earth, they would be living in a country which is very much dependent on oil. So oil is interesting, right? Let's look more at oil. Let's now look at this robustness aspect of oil. Well, if you look at robustness aspects of oil, you will see that compared to other fossil fuels, we probably don't have that much oil left. Although, of course, you know, you can debate what is resource, etc. But what I find extremely interesting is in some countries, particularly in Asia, oil consumption grows very, very rapidly because more and more people buy cars. Now, if you put these two and two together, right, you see that not much left, consumption grows very rapidly, and you don't really have it, it's in some other country. You're already like getting the picture of a vulnerable system. Now let's look at resilience, right? I make these two graphs from you. This is an energy mix in transport and electricity in the world. Of course, every country is slightly different, right? You can see that electricity mix is pretty diverse, right? And oops, right, well, shall we look at this again, right? I want to introduce this concept of diversity, right? We can calculate mathematical indexes which reflect, show that this system is different, right? So if something happens to oil, there is nothing to replace it with in most countries. Something happens to gas, most countries can replace it, right? So if we put these three things together, right, we come to not very surprising conclusion, but a very illustrative one, that oil is at the center of global energy security at present, right? This is the most vulnerable system globally at the moment. And then now we can ask the question, what will shape global energy security in the future? Because in the future, in the long-term future, there will be no oil, almost in every scenario, right? But maybe something else. Maybe there will be biofuels, and they will be exactly like oil now, or synthetic fuels, or hydrogen. So like one thing I believe is that when you look in the future, these three perspectives, they are useful. They were there for 100 years now, and they will probably be for 100 years to come. So this is useful to look from these three perspectives, right? Well, but what will be vital energy systems? You know, we can kind of discuss it. And I'll mention some ideas about it. But first, you know, before we discuss the prospects, right, energy security in the future, which future? How do we know what future is? What are the ways to, you know, think about it? And I'm now talking long-term future, not 2040, but longer term. Right. Well, and then there are several ways. One is you can try to forecast the future, you know, just basically calculate it. How is it going to be? But it is basically impossible for the purposes of energy security, right? You can forecast the demand, but how can you forecast prices? For example, just one example of uncertainties, right? Well, some people don't bother about forecasts. In some countries, they just plan the future. They say, well, European Union will have 80% of that coming from that, right? That's the plan. Don't care about forecasts, we just make it happen. Well, the question is, do you have capacity to make it, right? Can you create this future? Well, and then there are, of course, people who envision, who dream about the future, right? But then the problem with dreaming is everybody dreaming in the same way? How do you sort of align it? And I will work with the fourth way of looking in the future on scenarios. Right, it's not forecast, not your plan, not your vision. It's what plausible future which might be, you know, imaginable, right? Based on certain rules. And the studies I'm going to report, they're based on 70 scenarios. And all these scenarios, they are produced by integrated assessment models, which are kind of, they use slightly different ideology, but they are all used also by IPCC. So they are very widely used in the policy world, 2100. Now, 70 scenarios are produced by a combination of various assumptions about the future. Like, for example, climate policies. Are we going to have weak, strong, known? How are we going to share the burden of climate policies? Supply-side technologies. Are we going to phase out nuclear, keep nuclear, allow CCS, allow bio-CCS, hydrogen, and stuff like that? And some other things. GDP growth, foreign, you know, fossil resources. You can explore all of this in scenarios if you have good enough models. And this is how a typical output of a typical scenario looks, right? This is a 2-degree scenario, so it's just sort of very climate aggressive scenario. And what I want to like sort of show you, we are somewhere here, right, is that the energy mix changes quite dramatically, right? They change differently in different scenarios, but all scenarios change energy mix. And that means that we have to look at slightly different energy systems. In particular, we do have to pay attention to biofuels, fuel, right? There is more biofuel here than oil today, right? We have to pay attention to things like solar and stuff like that. Now, of course, you can imagine that there is like a lot of various, you know, numbers and graphs. I'll show you probably one, because, you know, otherwise you will accuse me that I'm not really good, so not quantitative. And this is a very simple graph. This is a graph of global energy trade in 2050 and 2100, generated in three scenarios by six different models. This is global energy trade today. You see, most of it is oil, and it's about 100 exajoules. Well, this is the baseline scenario. Like, the baseline is basically we don't do much. You see how much trade grows? Grows a lot, yeah? And you see that most of the trade model is actually coal, not oil. Where does coal come from and end up in? What regions? Well, it varies slightly between models, but in most models it comes from North America and goes to China, right? So that is what happens in the world with no climate policies. Well, if you look into Copenhagen commitments, at most models they say that the trade will be slightly less, but still very high. And if you look at, you know, very strong climate commitments, you can see that the trade basically doesn't grow over the 21st century. And yes, there is biofuel trade, you know, this green thing and coal trade, but it doesn't really become much more than we have oil trade today. And the world is, of course, much bigger by that time, you know, there is a bigger energy system. So what you can say by this illustration is that if you have no climate policies, these issues that we have, they are going to grow, right, systematically and globally. If you have climate policies, they are probably going to be less. Let's look at one of the robustness kind of angles, right? And it's another very simple thing, right? We are looking at the resources which we have left, and we are looking how much of this we will use over the 21st century. If we have climate policies or not, it's just two scenarios. And you can see that there is some problem with oil, right? Some models show that, you know, we use more oil than projected by most reasonable estimates. And of course, you cannot use 106% of something, right? But it just shows systemic problems that we will always need to look for new resources for new oil, not so much for gas and coal. And then I'm just very quickly showing, but you probably already guessed that the diversity of energy systems, the diversity will actually increase. But what is interesting is that even in baseline, the diversity of transport sector, these red scenarios, it is going to increase. We will need other transport fuels. But if you have climate policies, the increase will probably be more rapid. And this actually is another scale, it's 2050. Well, now, I'm going to say a couple of words, and I'm now speeding up, about major economies. We looked very carefully at the European Union, China, India, and the US, because these are economies which are so big that they can be seen on the global resolution scale over the 21st century. And what we discovered shortly is that the European Union, India, and China will tremendously win from climate policies in terms of energy security, where the United States will in some aspects win, but in some aspects it will lose. Because the United States has so much fossil fuel resources and conventional that it, yeah, and it is, you know, it is a bit funny because now they're importing, etc., but most models show that in the 21st century they will export and they will make tremendous profits on it if there is no climate change. Okay, well, I'm going, you know, to skip through this summary of future energy security and go to my last point, which is, if you remember the research agenda, how I see the research agenda, what we need to do in these multidisciplinary settings. And I want to just show you one disconnect, right? I'm talking a lot about this, you know, I have like millions of these graphs, and we are talking about future energy systems in these scientific terms, what, you know, these plausible scenarios are. But of course, the future is not made by the scientific graph. The future is made by policymakers. And there is some sort of a gap between, like, what these guys think and what we need to do. And as scientists, we have to investigate this gap, right, and have to explain and relate somehow to it. And energy security is one way to look at it, because most likely, if you make them a bit, stylize them a bit, you know, they think, first of all, about energy security, right? Security is most important. And then if you use this definition, then you have a very useful policy concept of securitization, which helps you to understand why some energy systems suddenly become vital and some not. Why the European Union doesn't care about oil at all. It's not on the agenda, even though it imports as much oil as China. And China cares mostly about oil. And India cares mostly about coal. What is so different? Right? You cannot like just look at the numbers and understand it. So a recent article which I published, and I hope it, you know, I will open, try to open like slightly different research agenda, tries to analyze how these vital energy systems emerge through securitization. We looked at China with a couple of collaborators. And what happens is that if you have a vulnerable energy system, you usually have an institution which tries to present it as a national security issue. And if they are successful, then you have a securitization agenda. I'm finishing very soon. I just want to have my last slide, and it is not going to be on the prospects. It is going to be on this research agenda. Right? Because I think we have to create multidisciplinary science of energy security. And we have to understand through the concept of vital energy systems, not only vulnerabilities from different scientific perspectives, but also how they relate to policies and how the process of securitization occurs. Thank you very much. Thank you.